الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده المصطفى ونبيه المجتبى ورسوله المرتضى خاتم الأنبياء وإمام الأتقياء وسيد المرسلين وحبيب رب العالمين صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد مفتاح باب رحمة الله وسير الأسرار نور الأنوار المجتبى والمختار وعلى آله وأصحابه الأخيار المهاجرين والأنصار وسلم تسليما كثيرا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون صدق الله العلي العظيم قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام أما بعد يا عباد الله إني أوصي نفسي وإياكم بتقوى الله فاتقوا الله حيثما كنتم. Staying with the themes of previous khutbas that I've given, I want to take the time today to analyze exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about fasting. We are in the blessed month, alhamdulillah, because we get questions sometimes that are mind-boggling, questions that are ajib and ghareeb for Muslims. Somebody asked me recently, is fasting something that is found in the Quran, or is it something that these mullahs and mulawis invented? This type of question is mind-boggling to me. First of all, it depicts that we have a very low opinion of our ulama, that we should respect the scholars. It's very important that this is a disease of our age, that there's a mistrust, there's a distrust of our ulama. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Akrimul ulama, innahum warathatul anbiya. Faman akramahum faqad akrama Allahu rasulahu," aw kama qala alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, "Respect the scholars, they are the inheritors of the prophets. Whoever respects them has respected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger." So sometimes we Muslims, we get stuck into this sort of progressive mindset, so-called progressive. We get to this like postmodern intellectualism. So we start to say things without knowledge. We start to say things like, you know, fasting, that was for back then because there was a shortage of food in the desert, so I don't have to fast. This is when our aql, our intellect, gets in the way of our istislam, of our taslim, of our resignation and surrender and submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to accept sometimes that there are things that are beyond our intellect. And we just submit, because that's the meaning of al-Islam, is to submit. When Musa alayhi salam was at the edge of the Red Sea, when he was fleeing from the Fir'aun, and the Fir'aun was following him, and his junood, and his forces, and the Bani Israel, they said, "Inna la mudrakun," we're done, because they thought about it. From the standpoint of aql, we're standing at the Red Sea, there's nowhere to go. We're done, they're going to destroy us. What did Musa alayhi salam say? "Kalla inna ma'ya rabbi sayahdeen." No way. With me is my Lord. He's soon going to guide me. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Fa'awhayna ila Musa," that we gave wahi, we revealed to Musa alayhi salam, "Idrib bi asa al-bahra." Strike the sea with your asa, with your staff. Musa alayhi salam didn't say, wait a minute, what is that going to do? Strike the sea with my staff? He didn't think about it. He didn't let his aql get in the way of this mu'jiza. This is a mu'jiza of a prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. Sometimes we have to resign ourselves to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There's a hadith in the Shamal al-Tirmidhi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was invited to a meal, a gathering, by a man named Abu Ubayd. And Abu Ubayd, he cooked this sheep for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And a group of Sahaba were there. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to Abu Ubayd, he says, "Nawilni al-dhira', give me its forequarter, the shoulder." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he liked to eat from the shoulder of the sheep. "Nawilni al-dhira', serve me the forequarter." So Abu Ubayd, he gave him the forequarter. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't eat much. He took a few bites, and then he passed it to the Sahaba, and they would eat from his leftovers. This is how they would get tabarruk, blessings from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he said to Abu Ubayd, "Nawilni al-dira', give me the forequarter." So he gave him the other forequarter, and he took a few bites, alayhi salatu wasalam, and then he passed it to the Sahaba. And then he said, "Nawilni al-dira', give me the forequarter."
And Abu Ubaid said, Ya Rasulullah, what kam lishati min dira'? How many forequarters, how many shoulders does a sheep have? Maybe he lost count. وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِي The Prophet ﷺ said, I swear by the one who holds my soul in his hand. لَوْ سَكَتْ If you had been quiet, لَنَا وَلْتَنِي الدِّرَعْ مَا دَعُوتْ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام If you had been quiet, you would have served me a forequarter every single time I had asked you. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. We can't have paralysis from overanalysis. They made wudu back then because they were dirty. Astaghfirullah. What are you talking about? If you took a 1 hour shower and you scrubbed yourself for 1 hour and then you stepped out of the shower and you broke wind, guess what? You have to make wudu. It's because you're dirty? No, we have to resignate ourselves to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what does the Quran actually say about fasting? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 183, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, ism mawsool, there's takhsis. He's talking about the believers, al-mu'minun, the Muslims. He's not talking about everyone. There's some, again, postmodern intellectual Muslims, so-called progressives, who say that every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, He's talking about anyone who believes in God. Anyone who believes in any God. So he's talking to the Jews and the Christians, he's talking to Hindus, he's talking to Buddhists. No. How do we know that? Because when this ayah was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, did he impose the siyam on the Bani Israel in Medina? If they're alladhina amanu, did he say you Jews have to fast now? No. Has there ever been a Muslim polity in the history of Islamic history that has imposed siyam on a group of non-Muslims living under a Muslim polity, a Muslim government? No. So, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا is for the Muslims, المؤمنون. Who are the Muslims? Do we mean Muslims? And we're all submitted to God, everyone. The Hindu is submitted, the atheist is submitted. Al-Islam. There's an alif lam. That means there's takhsis. This is a rarefied form of Islam. Al-Islam. وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَيْ يُقْبَلُ مِنْهُ Whoever desires a religion other than Al-Islam, this rarefied form of submission. What is Al-Islam? Belief in the Qur'an and in the finality of the prophecy of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam. Kutiba, from kataba, means to write or to prescribe. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says kutiba, that means it's been ordered, it's wajib or followed. Like he says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 216. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum al-qitalu wa huwa kurhun lakum. Prescribed upon you is qital. Qital is the third form mustar, which is associative. Not prescribed upon you is to go attack and be aggressors. No, to defend yourself, qital, to fight in the battlefield, if need be, even though you detest it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنْ عَصَى تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ Maybe there's something that you don't like, but it is good for you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the hikmah, He knows the wisdom behind it. So you say to yourself, what is fasting? I don't understand it. Why do I make wudu? Why if I break my wudu, I have to wash my feet? What does that have to do with anything? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows the wisdom behind these things. So fasting based on this ayah, kutiba alaykum as-siyam, yani katab Allahu alaykum as-siyam. But this is mabni ala al-majhul. Kutiba is in the passive voice, which adds to the eloquence of the Arabic. So the hukum of fasting then is followed. It is compulsory upon every Muslim. Muslim that has aql, that has a sane mind, that has buluf, that is an adult, and has ilm, has knowledge of the fast, they must fast. It's interesting. I heard from a Muslim lady recently, in her late 30s, born and raised Muslim. She said, I'm doing so good this year. I just have a light breakfast and a cup of coffee in the afternoon. I'm doing so good this year. I'm doing so good. You're Muslim your whole life. You didn't just convert to Islam. You've been Muslim your whole life. It's haram to eat during this time. This is farad, right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, faradallahu alaykum as-siyam. This hadith. This dalil qat'i in the Qur'an. We have to fast. It's fard. What does fard mean? What is the hukum of fard, the legal ruling of fard mean? That if we do it, we're rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though we're supposed to do it. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though we're supposed to do it, and we do it, we're rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if we don't do it, then we become liable for the wrath and anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we have to keep in mind. Kutiba alaykum al-siyam. What does siyam mean? It means to stop something in its archaic meaning. Like the Arabs say, قَدْ سَامَتْ الشَّمْسِ The sun has stopped, meaning it's reached the meridian, the zawal. It's going to descend now. That's when dhuhr starts. Right? To stop something. Abstinence. Abstention. What do we stop from doing? We stop from eating and drinking. We stop from relations with our spouses. And there's other things we stop as well that we're going to talk about. It means to stop. This is a time in which the licit, the halal becomes haram upon us. One of the salaf said, you'll never reach true taqwa unless you leave the permissible for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does that mean? Imam Shafi'i said, things that are mubah are haram upon me. Because I am a Shafi'i. What is mubah? Like you spend 2 hours a day working out. You don't have to do that. Spend 30 minutes, 45 minutes. If you go over, even though it's permissible to do that, the ulama, the khas, the elite, they'll say you're wasting your time, even though you're doing something permissible. So this is a training program in which we want to mimic the khas and the awliya and those that are near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and al-anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam, which we leave the licit, we leave the permissible. We leave the permissible to discipline the soul. This is siyam. كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ As it was prescribed upon those before you. Islam did not invent siyam or sawm. This is found multiple times, for example, in the Old Testament, the New Testament. When the Prophet ﷺ went to Medina. But before that time, even before Islam, before the Bi'tha, the Jahili Arabs, they would fast on Yomi Ashura. They would fast on the 10th of Muharram. And this was almost seen as a wajib amongst their community, that you have to fast on this day. And there's some athar, there's some reports that don't have strong sanad that mention things like the Ark of Nuh alayhi salam, it docked on Jabal Judi on Yomi Ashura, Isa alayhi salam ascended on Yomi Ashura. Allahu alam. These things don't have strong sanad. But for some reason, the pre-Islamic Arabs, the Quraysh, were fasting on Yomi Ashura. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, he went to Medina to Munawwara, he noticed that Bani Israel was also fasting on this day. So he said, ma hadha. In other words, why are you doing this? And they said, this is to commemorate the exodus of Musa alayhi salam from the grip of the Fir'aun. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, he said, we have a greater claim upon Musa alayhi salam. So he ordered the Sahaba to fast on this day. Although according to Abu Hanifa, this is a sunnah mu'akkada, to fast on Yomi Ashura. And he also said to fast on the ninth day as well, to differentiate yourselves from the Bani Israel. To fast on the ninth and the tenth, or the tenth and the 11th. This is a strong sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Actually, Abu Hanifa says, makruh, just to fast on Yomi Ashura now. You have to fast on 2 days consecutively. Right? So this is something that was ordered beforehand. The New Testament, Al-Ahd al-Jadid, it says that Isa alayhi salam, of course this is not a strong source, there's no sanad, it's in the wrong language, right? This is FYI, for your information. Right? So don't talk to me after the khutbah and say, brother, you shouldn't put the Bible in the khutbah, astaghfirullah. This is according to their own sources. This is FYI for you. Isa alayhi salam would fast 40 days on end in the wilderness. He'd go into the wilderness. And back then, they would fast and they wouldn't even speak. It was haram to speak. For the previous ummah, it was haram to even speak. You have to take a vow of silence. Inni nazartu lirrahman sawman falan ukallima al-yawma insiya. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Maryam alayhi salam said, I have vowed a fast to the Ar-Rahman, to the most gracious. I'm not allowed to speak to anyone today. This is how they used to fast. So this is something that was made obligatory upon those who came before us. La'allakum tattaqun. In order for you, la'alla, right? This is tawakkur. This is for expectation. Expecting you to become people of taqwa. This is the expectation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To become people of taqwa. كَمْ مِنْ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الذَّمَى The Prophet ﷺ said, how many people fast and they get nothing from their fast except hunger. They complain all day, I'm hungry, I'm hungry. They get these grouchy moods. You can't even be around them. Non-Muslims notice it. I heard a non-Muslim yesterday. She said, my cousins are Muslim, they fast, but I can't approach them when they're fasting. They're so moody. I said, astaghfirullah. I have to be extra happy for her. I'd be extra cheerful. Put on a big happy face because of other Muslims are being grouchy when they're fasting. This turns people away from Islam. We're hindering people from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La'allakum tattaqoon. What is the objective? What is the hadaf? What is the objective, the aim of fasting then? Is to become people of taqwa. And the ulama say there's an axiom that the reality of something is known by its objective. The objective of fasting is taqwa. Therefore fasting is highly exalted. in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in no anthropomorphic way. It's a figure of speech. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the greatest of creation. He's the greatest human being, period. The greatest of creation, of khalq. Why? Because his only objective was what? Was who? Was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was his only objective. So taqwa, in pre-Islamic times, because these words taqwa, obviously these were around before Islam. What does taqwa mean before Islam? It meant to parry a blow. If someone lunges towards you with a sword and you parry the blow, that's called a taqwa. It means a shield, wiqaya. Wiqaya, a shield. What are you shielding yourself from? You're shielding yourself away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there are 7 inroads to the heart. There are 7 inroads to the heart. It's not just the stomach. Yes, if we eat and we're satiated, the ulama say, then the nafs, it becomes restless and it wants to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we deprive the stomach, but the stomach is only one inroad to the heart. And there are a few things, and I'm talking primarily to the Shabab. There are a few things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not like for people physically. I have to mention these things. There are a few things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he pointed out, he didn't like about people physically. He didn't like a shaved face with a huge mustache that's covering your mouth. He didn't like that. Don't have this look. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't like it. Right? And this is an ancient Persian type of look that many Iranians still have. I can pick on the Iranians because I'm from Iran. Don't have this look. The Prophet didn't like it. Also a mohawk. I see Muslim children all the time with mohawks. What are the parents doing? It's no, it's not a mohawk, it's a faux hawk. It's fake, it's not really a mohawk. No, it's a mohawk. Don't have a mohawk. The Prophet ﷺ did not like that look. The Prophet ﷺ did not like tattoos. He didn't like this. This is haram in our sharia. One time a brother texted me from another state. He said, I'm in a tattoo parlor. How haram is a tattoo? I said, haram is haram. How haram? Haram jiddan. Very haram. What's the difference? It's haram. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not like a big stomach. He didn't like this big stomach. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had 3 folds in his stomach when he was in his 60s. He had a 6-pack. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He didn't eat a lot. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this is one of the ways which protect our heart. What we eat, we preserve our stomachs. But there are 7 inroads to the heart. The next is the eyes. When we're fasting, our eyes have to fast. We have to do this all the time, obviously. But when we're fasting, it's more prevalent. It's at the forefront of our brains. It's on our purview when we're fasting to guard our eyes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَقُلِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغُضُّنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. Tell the believing men and women to cast down their gazes. Don't stare at people. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you look at something beautiful, you look at the haram, for a man, the first gaze is for you. But if you keep staring, and you don't turn away, if you keep staring at the haram, he said, bil ma'na, your iman is going to be pulled out of your eyeballs as long as you're staring at the haram. As long as you're staring. But if he said, if you avert your glances, you look away, and you get that bitter feeling, the men know what I'm talking about. You get that bitter feeling in your heart, oh, I want to look again. I want to look again, I want to look again. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, bitter feeling that you get, that's converted into a nur, into light, which becomes the light of iman. And you taste the halawat of iman. You taste the sweetness of faith. So we guide our eyes from looking at the haram. Imam Suhaib said, the greatest barometer of iman in our times is al-computer. The computer is the greatest barometer of our iman. Because when you're in your room with your computer, and you think to yourself, this is absolutely private. I have absolute privacy. Believing in absolute privacy is kufr. You're never private. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you wherever you are. Wherever you are. We have to be careful about this. This again is a disease of our age. We have to guard our ears from hearing the haram. Get rid of these. 99.9% of the music you hear on the radio is haram. Don't listen to it. It makes you forget things. It puts you into states that are not even reality. Listen to the lyrics. We have to realize this. The youth have problems with this. Get away from these gadgets. Listen to the Quran. Listen to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you say, well, I don't like doing that. Well, the nafs has to be trained. And after a while, it becomes part of your habit. That's why you have Ramadan. To get away from these gadgets, to train the nafs, so that becomes part of our habit, our adat. So that we love listening to the Quran. We love reading the Quran. We love listening to speeches and lectures that deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the hands and the feet are the next two. And then the genitals and the tongue. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ يَضْمَنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ أَضْمَنْ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever can guarantee for me that which is between his jaws, meaning his tongue. The tongue is not making ghibah. Ghibah to ash-shajr min az-zina. He's not making ghibah. He's not slandering people. He's not backbiting people. He's not lying about people. He's not speaking excessively. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not speak excessively. And when people spoke to him excessively, he would have taghafud, like he's not even hearing them. He would ignore them. He didn't like that, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People have chatter mouth, chatting all the time. They can't have a moment of silence with their Lord. They get uncomfortable, start looking at their watch. We never look at our watch, we're watching TV, a 4-hour movie marathon, Bollywood video, right? They have these musalsalat during Ramadan. They put them on specifically during Ramadan, all night long. These cliffhangers, you have to sit there and watch 4 hours. Forget about the Taraweeh. Forget about Salat al-Isha. They sit there after they're eating and they watch 4 or 5 hours of these TV shows that have cliffhangers. You have to watch the next week, you have to watch the next week. All shows are like this now, if you notice. Reality television. He says, I guarantee for you, if you guarantee what is between your jaws, your tongue, right, and between your thighs, فَخِلَيْهِ, meaning the genitals, then I guarantee for you al-Jannah. I guarantee for you paradise. Nas'alullah al-afiyah wa salama. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us soundness and well-being, and to give us a tawfiq to implement these words. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. A few days fasting. It's a few days. And people say, no, it's so long, it's too hot, I can't do it, it's too much, I can't do it. Then we have Muslims going on these almond shake diets. They have 2 almond shakes, one for breakfast, one for lunch, and they have like 500 calorie dinner, and they do this for their entire life. That's hard! I tried to do this one time, I got to day 2. Fasting is easy. Ayyamu ma'dudat. It's just a few days. Why are we complaining? Why do we convince ourselves that Islam is something hard? It's not hard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to put us into hardship. He doesn't want to do that. He wants us to glorify Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not something that's hard, even in the summer months. Don't tell yourself this is hard. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيدًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَى. If you should be sick or traveling, that means sick, legitimately sick, you're ill, you don't have to fast. You can make those days up later. Or if you feel sickness coming on, you don't have to fast. You can make those days up later. But what you can't do is intentionally make yourself sick. Or be neglectful, be negligent and make yourself sick. Like we eat suhoor. I've been around people who eat suhoor. And suhoor is mustahab. It's a recommended practice to eat the pre-dawn meal and to delay it just before fajr. This is mustahab. It's a beautiful practice to do. But people have these 5-course meals, and then they get stomach issues, and they got diarrhea during the day, and they say, Ana marid, I'm sick, I'm gonna eat now. So you spoil the fard for the sake of a mustahab. We should have discipline. Or they have a porterhouse steak for suhoor, and they don't drink any water. It's adhan, oh, I didn't drink any water. So the next day they're completely parched, and they convince themselves, I'm sick. No, we should have discipline. We should eat the suhoor, but have discipline and hydrate ourselves. It's very important. Or if you're on a journey, in the opinion of Abu Hanifa here, the opinion of the Hanafi school here, Ibn Abidin, is a relied upon opinion that you have to start the day as a musafir in order to qualify as a musafir. You have to start the day at fajr as a musafir, and there's other opinions, wallahu a'lam. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and people ask me all the time about this issue, we'll mention it briefly. We had a fiqh seminar about a week ago. What happens if I accidentally break my fast? So what if I intentionally break my fast? We have to know these things. This is basic fiqh. We have to know the fiqh, the essence of our religion. Fiqh in its etymology means the essence of something. That if you break your fast, khata'an, if you should accidentally break your fast, this is why we have to be careful. Let's say you're making wudu, and you're rinsing out your mouth, and you accidentally swallow some water, because the reflex of swallow when you're fasting is very powerful. We have to be very careful. Or you're brushing your teeth. People always have these questions about toothpaste, or toothpaste mafia. Can I brush my teeth with toothpaste? Yes, it's makruh, be careful. And so I swallowed some toothpaste. Don't brush your teeth with toothpaste, ya akhi. Just don't do it. Your breath is going to stink anyway. And that smell is beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Mr. Jones at my work doesn't like it. Okay, keep your distance from Mr. Jones a little bit. Right? It's going to smell regardless. So if you break your fast accidentally, you drink some water, and you know you were fasting, then you have to make qada of that day. You make up that day. But you can't continue to eat. It is makruh tahriman to continue to eat. You have to stop all eating. You can't say, well, I broke my fast, bring on the samosas, bring in the qabli. No, you can't. You make up that day. There's qada. This is called qada. Right? This is khata'an. If you should do it nasiyan, if you should forget, let's say you completely forgot you were fasting, and you had three samosas, and you're done, and then you remember, Allah, I was fasting. You don't have to induce vomit. No, Allah fed you. Alhamdulillah. There's no qada. You don't have to make it up. If you completely forgot you were fasting. But if you break your fast, ta'i'an muta'annidan, amadan, on purpose, right? Willfully, you're not being forced. No one's compelling you. And you do it intentionally, then you have to make up the day and you have to do the kafara. You have to do the expiation. And the expiation, we need to study these things. It's fasting 60 consecutive days or feeding 60 poor people masakin, two meals a day, the same 60 people. Or freeing a slave, which is somewhat obsolete. 60 consecutive days. And if you get to day 58 and you break it, guess what? You have to start over again. So we have to take these things seriously. Right? We have to know the fiqh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُتِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ تَعَامُ الْمِسْكِينَ. But if it's hard for you, if you can hardly fast, then you can pay the fidya, which is half a sa'a of wheat. It's very small. You make a payment. تَعَامُ الْمِسْكِينَ. You feed the poor. And this is for who? This is for Sheikh Fani or Ajuz Faniya, a very elderly man or woman. So you can't say, well, I'm a senior citizen, I'm 62 years old, but I play an hour of basketball every night. I don't have to fast. I'm 62. The law says. They have to pay the fidya. Or someone who's chronically ill. Someone who's chronically ill, has like really hardcore diabetes. Right? And you just can't do it. The blood sugar won't let them fast. Then you pay the fidya. But everyone else has to fast. My respected brothers and sisters, don't make excuses for yourself. At Islam, wal aql, wal bulugh, wal ilm, these are the shurut. You're Muslim. You're an adult. You have sound mind and you know you have to fast. Then you have to fast. It is fard, it is fard ain upon all of us to fast. And then he says, فَمَنْ تَتَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ. But if you give more, that is better for you. وَأَنْ تَصُومُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. But if you fast, that is better for you. إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. If only you knew. It's better to fast. If only you knew. كُلُّ عَمَلِ إِبْنِ آدَمْ لَهُ إِلَّا السِّيَامِ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَجْلِ بِهِ. The Prophet ﷺ said, in a hadith Qudsi, this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking in the first person on the tongue of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every action of the son of Adam is for him except fasting. That is mine. Fasting is mine. Leave. Innahu li. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and I will reward him for it. And this reward is beyond your imagination, because only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows your fasting. So even if you're sick, if you look at the khas, if you look at the elite of the elite, even when they're sick, even when they're fighting in the qital, they're fasting. At the Battle of Mu'tah, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, who is the brother of Imam Ali, one of the older brothers of Imam Ali, karamallahu wajhah, in the Battle of Mu'tah against the Byzantine Empire in the north, the Prophet ﷺ was not there at the time, but he received the ru'ya yaqadha, a vision, an awakened state, where he was able to follow the battle while he was in Madinah. And he said that Ja'far, his arms had been amputated in the battle. He was carrying the niwa, and his arms had been amputated. He had 70 wounds to his torso. 70 times they had punctured his flesh on his torso. They found him face down in the hot sand. His face was laying in the sand. No arms. Brother of Imam Ali, Imam Ja'far. So they turned him over. They turned him over and they wanted to give him water. Make haste to give him water. And then saw him. I'm fasting. He was fasting. SubhanAllah. Because these people understand that fasting is better. In kuntum ta'alamun, if only you knew. In kuntum ta'alamun means Allah saying, if only you knew, fasting is better. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. That the month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed. And the whole Quran came down, أنزل إلى السماء الدنيا. It came down to the first heaven. And then نزل And then it came piecemeal to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam over the next 23 years. Hudan linnas, a guidance for all of humanity. Again, we have this postmodern Muslim intellectual mindset today that's found in Western Academy that says all religions are talking about the same transcendent reality. It doesn't matter which religion you follow, they're all the same. Right? And they say things like, the Quran, it's contextual for the Arabs. It speaks to them psychologically, culturally, theologically. What kind of revisionist garbage is this? You read the Quran? Linnas. What does Allah say in the Quran? Hudan lil Arab? No. Hudan linnas. Alif lam. This is for the entire whole of humanity. Alif lam. Istikhraqiyya. For everyone. This Quran is a guidance for everybody. وَبَيْنَاتِ مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. Clear signs of guidance, and the Furqan, a criterion by which we judge truth and falsehood. The Quran is our judge. The Quran is our barometer. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُومَ. Whoever witnesses the month, let him fast. And there's two ways of doing this. And this shouldn't be a cause of fitna. And these two ways were done by the Salaf. One way is بِرُؤْيَةِ hilal. You actually sight the moon. You sight the moon. Right? And if it's the 30th of Sha'ban or the 1st of Ramadan and there's clouds in the sky, then you take Ramadan as 30 and you take Sha'ban as 30 days, khalas. It's very easy. بِرُؤْيَةِ hilal. Or you can calculate it. And this is something that the Salaf used to do. These people in the past, these were brilliant polymaths. Al-Biruni, Imam Ghazali, Ibn Taymiyyah. These people were unbelievable geniuses. You don't think they thought about calculation? No, they thought about calculation. But in the end they said the sunnah is better because you get the barakah of the sunnah. But both ways are permissible. We shouldn't make an issue out of this. Wallahi, we shouldn't make an issue. It's dividing our community. Both ways were practiced. Calculation or bi ru'ati hilal. This is two ways to make shahada of the moon. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to say, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيدًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرَ. Again, if you're sick or on a journey, He repeats this subhanahu wa ta'ala to let you know that this is not hard. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. He does not want to put you in difficulty. He wants to make it easy for you. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith in Bukhari. One of my favorite hadith. A man broke his fast intentionally in Ramadan. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Rasulullah, I had intercourse with my wife. What do I do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, fast 60 consecutive days. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I failed on day 8 or 9. I can't do 60 days. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, go free a slave. He said, I can't afford it. He said, go feed 60 masakin. I have nothing. The Prophet ﷺ himself went out and got a huge basket of dates. And himself gave it to the man. He said, here, take this and feed people. He said, feed whom? Masakin, the feed people, the poor people. The man said, Wallahi, there is no people more poor, more poverty stricken in the city of Madinah except Ahli, my own family. My own family is the most poverty stricken people in Madinah. So the Prophet smiled at him and said, take it and feed your family with it. Right? The Prophet ﷺ is trying to find a way for this man. But that doesn't mean we're negligent about our fast. No, this is something we have to take very, very seriously. This just demonstrates that the Prophet ﷺ is bil mu'minina ra'ufur rahim. Harisun alaykum. He's deeply concerned about us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ. And in order for you, لَا مُتَعْلِيرٍ. And in order for you to complete the period, وَتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. And to make takbir, to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He has guided you. I've heard from Muslim youth a lot, that they're envious of non-Muslims. They get to eat, they get to have fun, I have to fast. They're envious, I want to do that. Astaghfirullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala singled you out amongst the dhulumat, amongst darknesses, and gave you a nur called Al-Islam. This is the greatest ni'mah. The greatest ni'mah. And we don't have shukr. We don't make shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We envy non-Muslims because they get to eat their own. You're going to eat in a few days, ya akhi. Be patient. Usbur. You're going to eat a lot. Right? So we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La'allakum tashkurun. Perhaps you might give thanks. We're running out of time. But the very next verse, you know, the verses in every surah, because a surah is a literary unit. There's cohesion in every surah. Nothing's haphazard. This next verse is related to what came before. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. When my servants ask you concerning me, say, I am qareeb, I am close. Don't listen to these anti-Muslim profligates who tell you that the God of Islam is a distant God. He's not a personal God. He's a remote God. He wants to crack the whip on your back. You're a slave and he's your master. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a close God. He's imminent. Not in the sense that I'm close like I'm close to you in terms of space, time, or dimension. He is close to us. He is qareeb in the relational sense. In the sense that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forsake us as long as we don't forsake Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. That He is close to us. And we should know this. And this is a call to make dua during this month. Ujibu da'wata da'i ila da'an. I hear the supplicant whenever he calls upon me. Make dua. Our prayer, our salawat, there are five prayers. Those are in Arabic. And we don't move on those things. We don't change. We're not the Catholic Church. We don't say, okay, pray in any language you want. No, they're in Arabic. Because this is our tradition from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this unifies Muslims. And the prayer has a discipline. And they're done in Arabic. But after your prayer, the next 23 and a half hours a day, be in supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the language that you know best. Don't make rules for yourself. I can't make dua because I have to be sitting on my sajada in a certain place in the musalla. I have to have my kufi on. I have to have a 5 o'clock shadow. I have to have my clean thobe on. I got to raise my hands up. Then I have to be in wudu. In fact, I have to be in ghusl. No, you don't need to do that. You can make dua driving in your car, eating your food, sitting in your cubicle at work, constantly be speaking and talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Constantly speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Constantly. The Sahaba had to put stones underneath their tongues when they're in the bathroom to remind themselves to forget. To remind themselves to forget when they're in the bathroom. Because they're constantly making dua. They're constantly making adhkar, making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should be speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the day. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي. So let them answer me. وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. And believe in me. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Perchance they might be guided spiritually. Irshad is spiritual guidance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us spiritual guidance. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله المصطفى وعلى ساداتنا وإمتنا أبي بكر عمر عثمان وعلي ورضي الله تعالى عن أصحاب رسول الله أجمعين. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد نقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم إنا نسألك بنور وجهك الكريم وبحقك عليك حسن الخاتمة عند الممات لنا ولأحبابنا ولجميع المسلمين يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا الشر ما قضيت. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. يا مقلب القلوب الأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. يا مقلب القلوب الأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على طاعتك. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا يا كريم. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والحمد لله رب العالمين. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وأقيموا الصلاة.